This is the Drummers Resource Podcast, session 371. And the quote of the day is, "With wisdom comes the desire for simplicity."
You're listening to the Drummers Resource Podcast, home of in-depth interviews with the world's greatest drummers, music industry professionals, and thought leaders. Inspiration, education, and motivation for drumming and beyond.
What's going on, everybody? This is Nick Ruffini, and this is the Drummers Resource Podcast, and I hope you're doing well. And I want to thank all of you for the great reviews that you've been leaving on iTunes. I really do appreciate it. The weird thing about the iTunes reviews is that although I see your username or whatever it is, I don't know who you are. So I can't thank you. I can't thank you personally, but I can thank you by your, I guess by your username or whatever it was. So Amanda plays the drums. Thank you so much. Not Be Rich, I appreciate it. Leo Drums, I appreciate it. Critic Kalmani, I think that's what it is. And then the other one is Z13KZ Hats. So I'm guessing it's Zildjian 13KZ Hats. I don't know. R. Borowski, all of you who are leaving these comments, I do appreciate it. Grove JBDR, I thank you for leaving a comment or for leaving a rating on iTunes. I do appreciate it. Some of the great things that everyone is saying, it's amazing, and I truly appreciate it. And it blows my mind every time I read these comments. So if you haven't already, please leave a rating or a review on iTunes. And it's not just feeding my ego. It actually helps the podcast show up higher in search results when people are searching for drums or drumming podcasts or anything like that. So by leaving a comment, yes, it makes me feel warm and fuzzy, but it's also helping out the podcast. It's helping other people know about the podcast. The other thing is, a lot of people ask me what they can do to help. Just share it. Anytime you have an episode that you're digging, just share it on social media, you know, use some hashtags, use drums and drummer and all that kind of stuff, and tag me in it, because I want to know if you're sharing this stuff. But yeah, that's the best way to help, is just share it on your social profiles and just get it out there and let people know what's going on over here at Drummers Resource. And I do appreciate all of that. So now that that's out of the way, let's get into part two of this conversation with John Fisham. I've gotten a lot of great feedback about it, tons of downloads, but also just a lot of people writing in telling me how much they enjoyed it and that they're digging the fact that I released it in two parts. So this is part two of the Fishman interview. For those of you who haven't heard part one, you can go check that out. This is literally just a 3.5 hour conversation that we found the best part in the conversation to cut it. And so we just split it in two. So if you listen to the first one, and or if you haven't listened to the first one, you don't necessarily need to listen to that one to understand what's going on in the second one. It wasn't like, you know, a prequel and a sequel, but you should check that first one out too. And that is episode 368. So you can check that out. And we'll get into it now with part two of the conversation with my man, John Fishman. So this has been floating around, and I read about this a long time ago, and I've looked for it, I've Googled it. What's the deal with this dissertation that you wrote in college? Did you actually write it, or there's rumors that you said it, or did it not even exist, or did somebody just make this shit up?
No, I wrote it. It was my senior study. It's called The Rumbling Earth. And it was my senior study. Oh no,
I'm talking about the drumming, the self-teaching guide to drumming in retrospect.
Self-teaching guide to drumming, yeah. So I had this thing. There was this, I honestly don't remember a single thing about it now, because I wrote the whole thing, and there's this one part where I was explaining upbeat and downbeat, mm-hmm. right? And your teach yourself how to drum thing. So, you know, you have to get this general concept of upbeat and downbeat. You know, so I said, well, in the book, I'm saying, well, when you're listening to music, you know, and you're bopping your head, you know, and you're doing this with your head, and you're going, you know, that when your head goes forward, that's the downbeat. And when your head goes back, that's the upbeat, you know, and then your head's going forward, that's, you know, simple, right? And Trey goes, Oh, you mean like in bluegrass, like starts putting his head forward on the downbeat. I'm going, oh my God, you know, forward on the upbeat. And I'm just in like 1 second, he completely delegitimized my explanation. Something, he made me realize like that was a 50-50 shot. And if you happen to be listening to something and you're the person that, you know, your head goes forward, happens to go forward on the upbeat. Now everything I said is totally wrong, and your entire concept going forward is going to be based on exactly
misinformation.
Misinformation. So I feel that it's probably that publication is a case of the difference between the skill of playing and teaching.
Right.
So this thing does exist, but it's just not going to see the light of day.
It does exist, and I would not recommend it to anybody. I think that it probably is wrong. Well, it's right if you read it and then you listen to music and your head goes down forward on the downbeat, you're off and running.
Do you still have it?
I've got it someplace. It's probably, it's in my, I think I have a copy of it.
Because, there's like people, I've read, like, I'm not super active on forums.
It's in the Goddard Library. You can go to the Goddard College, you can go to the library, and you can go find it.
So I read that someone tried to do that. They won't let them because they don't have your permission. So they're like, we reached out to Mr. Fishman, or tried to like, or we've in several attempts to reach out to Mr. Fishman and blah, 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 and all this stuff. So they can't release it without your express written consent.
Oh, you mean to what? To let them like photocopy it or something?
I guess. I don't know. I legitimately don't know that much about, I've read about the, about it. I don't even know where the fuck I read about it. I mean, this was like, I'll tell you this. I played with Paige at Nectar's in 2005. And I asked him about it then. So that's how long I've known about it. But I just read about this thing today that people were like trying to get it, and like they were trying to reach you to get it and all this stuff.
Do you play in a band in Burlington?
I did play in it. I was in Philadelphia, but we would tour and we would play. We played at Nectar's a lot.
Oh, what band?
The band was called Monacy, MONACY.
Never heard of you guys.
No. So we played with Grippo and Spam All Stars, and then, you know, did that whole thing. So
I never heard Monacy.
We weren't that good. You weren't missing anything.
Well, that study, I mean, maybe I'll go dig it out of my, I just unpacked boxes like a few months ago that I hadn't packed for 10 years. I'm pretty sure that it's in there. Because I did put a bunch of music stuff in the filing cabinet. I think it's this thing that I had that had my, cause my dad put it in a binder for me. I think,
I
think this hardcover thing I put in there, I think was that. Anyway, I could dig that out and maybe I'll go look at it someday and proofread it again and see if it's,
I want to see this thing.
If there's anything helpful in there that is any validity, that's not going to be screwing somebody up more than is going to be helping them, then maybe I'll put it out there just for fans to get a chuckle over.
Right. Or it'll be like stuff that I wrote years ago and I look at it and I'm like, what the fuck was I, what was I thinking?
I'm sure that, you know, look, considering the fact that it took me until 1996 to understand that part of my role of my instrument was in a pocket, that, you know, I would say that probably that there's a lot of stuff in that book that's missing.
There may be a few gaps.
And that could be good. That could be a good thing. Maybe that's, you know, maybe that's kind of like the way this started out, where we should talk about anything other than drumming. Thereby, through which we will then deliver the most informative drumming podcast ever created. Avoiding concept altogether.
Yeah. Like an updated version of a drumming guide in retrospect.
Right. Just a giant gap.
Yeah.
Giant gap in information.
Yeah. All right. So I have one sort of like technical question that I need to ask you. So I know that and we had talked about Harry Hood, and I think you do this in Harry Hood, where you're seemingly playing like, I guess you're playing singles between your hands, right? But they're separated. One's on the hi-hat, one's on the snare. And then, but you're still playing the backbeat at the same time. So it gives it like this flutter kind of vibe that you do, and you do it a lot. I mean, I've heard you do it in a lot of different tunes, and I can never figure out exactly how the hell you're playing. Do you know what I'm talking about?
You mean like that sort of shuffly thing that happens underneath the main groove?
It's just like a, it has like this flutter bounce to it.
Yeah, it's most of the time over the years that it's been, yeah, it is singles, just single strokes that are just, I guess, you know, in technically they're called ghost notes, right? I mean, people call them ghost notes. It's just a matter of kind of getting the ghost notes to sort of even out a little bit. But I've been going through, Bob Galati gave me Alan Dawson's Ritual, I'd never seen before. And I've been going, you know, readdressing the rudiments and, you know, getting into the drags and flams and just going through the, you know, the foot pattern that goes under. It's funny because the foot pattern underneath it is that part of it's not the hard part for me. It's the rudiments themselves. You know, some of them, like the flam a diddle diddle is ridiculous. I'm like, how the fuck does anyone even do this? But and I see people killing it. And, you know, but I thought, well, if you get that stuff to be really good, then those things like you're talking about, the little fluttery stuff underneath the main beat, it can be can not just be singles then. You know, then you can start, you know, getting that going with you know, different patterns. Mm-hmm. Because like the ritual, the way the ritual is, one of the really important parts of the ritual is putting the accents in rudiment where he wrote them.
Well, that was always what tripped me up with the thing that you play, is because you're not dropping your hand off the hi-hat to play the accent, right?
In that particular beat, in that particular Harry Hood thing?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I think you played in Harry Hood. Should have been better. Well, I should have been better. This is a shitty question, John. I'm sorry. I should have been better prepared with this question.
with the Harry Hood, with a lot of that stuff, it's not, if the stick is on the hi-hat at all, it's because it's pairing with, you know, either a downbeat or an upbeat that I'm playing, you know, on the hi-hat. So it'll be like a stick that'll happen right after the foot, you know. Right. And but a lot of times I think what you're hearing is that I'll change the foot from being to the on the upbeat to the downbeat, or I'll be playing it as an eighth note or a quarter note triplet. So it'll fit into those fluttery stuff and the single strokes and like, you know, it'll fall in that pattern. And
I got you.
Some consistency. And if you're closing a hi-hat and you're not really slamming it, it kind of sounds a little like a light hit on the snare drum. So they start to become slightly different textural sounds, but they have a homogeneousness to them as well.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's just a feeling, like you're trying to get that full. It's just a flow.
Yeah.
It's just part of the flow. It's just getting the flow going, and in between the bigger where the accents are, it's just kind of keeping the flow going.
Right.
And sometimes you put that there to create that feeling, but then you can take it away so that there's space in between. And that's, you know, where you have more like the funk and or, you know, ballady type grooves or something.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Well, that was it. That was the poorly researched question that I wanted to get out. So, but I want to thank you for taking all this time to chat with me, man. I do appreciate it. And after, like I said, after seeing you guys, after going to, you know, 90 fish shows, to actually be able to sit down and talk drums with you and talk about fish, this has been a real treat, man. And I really do appreciate it.
Well, it's a treat for me too. I like being able to talk shop on a shop talking type place where other people are listening. It's not like you're alienating anybody, you know. It's kind of a nice forum, and it's, you know, it's what we do, and everyone has something to provide there, you know. Mm-hmm. So I hope my thoughts aren't too scattered and that people can take away something useful from it.
No, there was a lot of useful information in here, and that's why I love it, how it's, I love the long form content, so we can get into topics. There's no agenda, you know, we can just talk about where it goes. So,
yeah. So do you put this whole thing out, or do you like go through and edit?
No, God, no, I don't edit this stuff. I just put it out.
10 minutes of space where he wasn't talking. Like, just, are you still there? Did you die?
Hello?
or all my, starting a thought and then going off into left field. It's funny because my my son just remarked that. He goes, "You have weird pauses. You know, you have weird pauses." Because, but Rose or somebody said, "Yeah, but you what? You usually end up coming back to where you, you know, like
I will I say, you do that. You'll go, like, you'll go out there, and then you're like, so to bring it back, and you do, you remember the question that was asked, or like go back to the original point."
Like, I know that as I get older, like, eventually that's going to stop happening, and it'll just be like, hey, he just wandered off again. You know, my master plan is to just actually physically one day, like, when it just gets really, you know, kind of like that time, just wander off.
What, like old Yeller?
Yeah, well, they found Grandpa. They found him in the snow, and he was like, the spring came, and they found me, you know, half decomposed out in some, you know, I don't know. It's kind of morbid, but I don't know.
Hey man, I think it's better than going a lot of different ways. You know.
Yeah. Right. You know, but who knows? Maybe by that point they'll find a way for all of us to live forever and populate Mars, and you know, there's all that sci-fi stuff. I feel like I live in the generation that's just gonna miss the whole sci. I feel like everything that actually that happens in science fiction actually, in one way or another, does eventually happen in reality.
Yeah,
it's not the same way like in Star Trek or beaming people up and wherever. But there's you know, but in real life, there's the 3D printer.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Yeah. And so you know, so it's like the you're approximating these concepts that were this right here, I mean, us Skyping, it's funny how normal this is, and the you know, the iPhone, you know, version FaceTime, of it, and the different FaceTime, and the different versions of, you know, this talking on the screens. And that's why at the beginning of this thing I was like, well, the asteroid I'm coming from, hi son, hi, it's been dad,
you know, is that you?
Oh, so you're 4 years old now, you know. Oh, I know that by the time you get this signal, 5 years will have passed and you'll probably be married and have kids. But, you know, I just want you to know I think about you all the time up here on Neptune. And, you know, like it's the sci-fi movies, right, where that's the only place it existed, like Blade Runner or something. And, yeah, you know, yeah. And then it started to happen in real life on these computer screens. And it's not like – for me, when I first saw Skype, I fucking flipped out. I was like, wait, this is real?
You could actually do this?
Wait, you could do this now? But it was like nobody around me reacted in a way like that this was weird at all. It was like it had been happening the whole time. And I was like, wait, this only existed in science fiction movies.
Yeah.
Like a year ago.
Yeah.
And now it's free.
Yep.
And it's ubiquitous.
My
nobody's going like,
and nobody's
oh
freaking
my.
And it's free. It's free. My
yeah,
mom
it's free.
That you know, my mom's 72 now, and she said that when she was a kid, her mom used to always say that people were going to walk around and they were going to have their phones in their pockets and there'd be no cords or anything attached to it. And you would be able to sit down and see the person that you're talking to. And my mom's like, no way. And she's like, I'm telling you, that's going to happen.
Right. And now it's not even the remote list. You know, well, what I've been walking around saying is like, you know, it's funny because I've had this thought for a long time. Like, you know, when's the chip, you know, that the chip that, you know, it's just the implant right here.
Yep.
And it just it's this. It interfaces and with your direct gray matter, and I got to do an interview with Nick Ruffini, and I just think of you, and then you think back, and we go you know, and there's some way to control that, and then like no one else can see it, but I'm looking at you.
Right.
We're having this conversation. And you're like a holographic image that only I can see.
I don't think that is even remotely far fetched.
Right. It's some weird thing. What I always want to do, like, you know, I used to say, like, in fish concert, like, where you could have, you know, the Lucky Charms guy who's like, moons, clovers, stars, yeah. And like, you know, they're appear spinning over his head. No, I want to be like doing a concert, like Kuroda's doing his lights, and suddenly there's just like shamrock spinning over, you know, Trey's head, or some shit like that. Like, it's real. It's really real. Like, it actually looks like he's about to get hit in the head with a big rubber shamrock.
People would lose their fucking minds.
Like, can you just sneak that in somewhere, like a real hologram, and just have it appear? And then,
well, did you see did you see the Tupac concert that they put on with the hologram at Coachella?
Oh, well, right. So, right. No, I didn't see it. But, right. So then the next thing I know, I'm hearing these things about, oh, there's going to be a Zappa tour where they have a hologram of Zappa, you know, playing or something. And it's like, or the Tupac thing or, you know, what? And there we go. Like, oh, wait. Oh, okay. Yeah, of course. This is going to be happening. This is going to be normal, you know.
That's insane. That's so insane. I think you guys should definitely do the Shamrock thing, though. You should definitely do the Shamrock thing.
Well, if it was going to be us, I wouldn't want to like bring back some dead person and from their film archive. I mean, I would want to do, you know, like really weird stuff that people, they go, they're sure that they hallucinated it. They're positive right. that nobody else saw it to the point where they
and
don't
no one
actually,
mentions it.
No, they don't want to. They really are kind of like, dude, I was so fucking high at that concert that I got to be honest with you. Trey was playing a solo and I was looking right at him and there was a smiley face over his head superimposed over his own face, but he turned into a giant emoji smiley face that actually replaced his head. That's how high I was. And then the friend go, oh my fucking God, I saw that too, but I didn't want to say it to anybody. You know, and have it be like for a second, you know, you don't, it's not like it just, you just go boom, like, and then the people that saw it and they really don't actually want to say anything to their friends about it because they're sure that they had a psychotic episode and they're worried that they could, you know, that they could be dragged into a mental clinic. Really, you know,
I want this entire life show to become a thing,
an entire thing that nobody is sure that they actually saw it, and they're a little nervous about mentioning it to anybody else.
I think I'd be more interested to see you go pitch this to Corona, and you're like, so I have an idea.
Oh, I'm sure Corona's already thinking about it. He's been with us as long as, you know, he's the oldest other member of the group, basically.
Right.
I'm sure that's not lost on him. Well, actually, the show, the rig we have now does do that a little bit because of the way that the beams will stay focused on a certain person, but
right.
the thing projecting the beam actually can be moving around, but the beam stays focused in its original spot.
Ah.
So, you know, the roof can tilt like that. But if there's if this light beam is pointing straight down, this entire rig can go like that, but the light beam will stay.
I got you. Yeah. Yeah.
And all the, you know, this light will be moving, but it'll be, you know, the beam will be adjusting and so it gives this appearance that they're, you know, I saw it in when we were test running the new rig, and it can gives this almost like, I think of it as like you know, what are those big machines in Star Wars, the sand walkers?
I don't know. I'm the wrong guy to ask for that.
You know, big robot machine.
Yeah, I know. It looks like a gigantic dog robot kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. It's like it's almost like one of those things is straddling the stage and moving around back there, and its shoulders are kind of, but it's black and it's sort of blended in. You can't see it behind the thing, but it looks like there's some massive thing
right
moving behind the lights, but it's not.
It's not.
It really does kind of give you this a little bit of an impression of like, is that the lights moving or is that some,
yeah,
is that an illusion or is that actually happening, you know? Yeah. And you know, it's starting, we're just at the scratching the surface of it, but I promise, but as soon as you get into deeper levels of that, you know,
speaking of the rig, I saw the video from not this year but 2 years ago of New Year's Eve, and as I'm watching it, I felt like somebody was like, oh, 10,000 balloons? I thought you said 100,000 balloons. Like,
oh, well, that was, yeah, that was funny. That was ridiculous.
I was like, they just kept coming. And I was like, holy shit. And they were, I was like, where the fuck are these balloons coming from?
Well, there was the whole, you know, petrichor soaked earth and the raining cats and dogs. Right. And so we got like as literally as dumbly literal as we could about it and actually had cat and dog balloons in the giant. You know, and I think it was the largest balloon drop in Madison Square Garden's history or some crazy like that. It was great. It was caricaturish. You know, it was this real Spinal Tap moment.
It totally was. Is there a reason why you guys are, I mean, you guys have been playing there a lot. Is it just that's the way it works or just?
One of the shows I said, we did the Boston Cream mashup, you know, the More Than a Feeling and the Sunshine of Your Love thing, you know, and that had been a running joke. Like the idea for the Baker's Dozen actually was 20 years old by the time we actually did it at the Garden. The original idea was we were on tour and the Providence Civic Center, I don't remember what year it was, but the Providence Rhode Island Civic Center went from being the Providence Civic Center to the Dunkin' Donuts Center. And we were laughing about, well, we should do 13 nights there, call it the Baker's Dozen, and have a different flavored donut every night and have it in the Dunkin' Donut box. And like you come in and you open your Dunkin' Donut box and today's donut's strawberry. And you like literally everything we did at the Baker's Dozen at the Garden had been an idea that had been rolling along and accumulating, snowballing effect. Accumulating other facets literally since the Dunkin' Donuts Center came into being in Providence. You look it up, whatever year that became the Dunkin' Donuts Center, that was the year we were like the Baker's Dozen. That would be this, you know, that was. And so then there was along the way, we thought, oh, you know, we kept talking about it and then we kept going, we'll do it for one of our festivals. And then for one reason or another, it wouldn't become the festival because, you know, it's not. How do you get through, you know, it's not 13 nights and, you know, and then I think earlier on, you know, even the idea of wouldn't it be incredible to do 13 nights and never repeat a song, you know, back when that idea first hatched, there was no fucking way we were going to be able to go 13 nights and not repeat a song. And so by the time, so as our career is going along, you know, our repertoire catalog of songs is growing, you know, naturally, and the bands, the venues we were playing in were evolving naturally, and you know everything was kind of organically going along, and there was this idea that just kind of never died. And in fact, the Boston Cream, literally More Than a Feeling and Sunshine of Your Love together, and that not that specific arrangement that ended up actually happening, but that idea was, well, one of the nights is going to be the Boston Cream Donut. Right. I mean, that one of the, like, we were thinking of the donuts. We're going, okay, well, chocolate, we could, you know, Chocolate Rain didn't exist at the time, but we were like, oh, you could do, you know, Chocolate City. Mm-hmm. You could do some P-Funk thing would be like Chocolate Night. And you could do, you know, the Strawberry Fields Forever was one that there was, you know, so, I mean, literally that Boston Cream, the whole thing was 13 nights without repeating. And originally the idea was you do the first 12 nights. If anyone buys all the whole thing, you get the 13th night for free, which we were unable to do logistically. It wasn't possible to do because you couldn't really track. You couldn't have a room, the entire Garden be filled with people who had only bought all 12.
Right.
You know, and then, you know, there wasn't enough people that were going to buy all 12 nights. And it was like originally that the 13th night would only be for the people that bought, you know, but you you can't put concert tickets on sale and then go, well, you can't buy one for that concert unless there were just impractical logistical things where that part of it could be done. But in every other way, it was implemented exactly how it had been conceived of for all those years. And it just gestated all that time. And then, you know, we were as surprised as anybody else when it became, oh my God, we are actually in a position physically to do the Baker's Dozen where we can actually go 13 nights and play mostly original material and get through all 13 nights and have all 13 nights be strong shows. You know, not like you don't get to the 13th night and you're only left with ballads and a couple covers, you know, right. Like, you know, I mean, even up to the last nights, you still had, you know, Bowie and You Enjoy Myself and you had other stuff on, plenty of things on the table. And in fact, we had like one or two other decently strong nights that we probably could have gotten 15 nights at one point. There was a conversation because there's 5 gigs leading up to the Baker's Dozen that were warm ups to Baker's Dozen. We're like, geez, wouldn't it be amazing if we started in Chicago and we didn't repeat a song through the entire run? But when we looked at it realistically, it became kind of unreasonable.
Yeah.
Because it would have just been like you'd have to do so many covers, and we kind of didn't want to do as many covers. We really did want to do it mostly original, and then so we were as surprised as anyone else when it got to where it was like, wow, we can actually do this. We have the material for it now. And the joke has stayed, you know, the idea hasn't become any less funny.
Right.
and we can do it we can't even do it at the Dunkin' Donuts Center anymore. The place that would be too small. It would create havoc in the
right.
City of Providence, you know? And the fact that we could do this in New York City at Madison Square Garden, that our career had grown to the point where that was the logical venue for such a thing,
mm-hmm.
You know, and then to have a relationship with the people there and with the staff and everyone from the promoters to the janitors. It's like,
I mean, you guys have played there a lot.
So good to us. They. I mean, I wouldn't say they love us. I can't speak for them, but I mean, I feel like I'm at home there. I know, you know, the guys backstage and the, you know, like at this point, I'm on first name basis with a lot of the people we see there that just in the hallway that work every concert there. You know, but it's like one guy, Tyrone. It's just like, you know, it's like, hey, Tyrone, how you doing? Like, he's like the. You know, I feel like I've known the guy. I mean, I have known him for, you know, 13 years or whatever it is.
Right.
And you know, so we, you know, it's just a combination of things. Like it just in one way, it naturally evolved that way. And in the other, it's the garden. Like how many bands get a chance even like to have a period of their career or their existence where the Madison Square Garden you get to have that as your normal office, your normal workplace as a performer, and that it's like a good fit, and it's just so it seems normal, you know what I mean? It's funny. It's like, you know, I'm not saying, you know, own the room or anything like that. I mean, whatever.
No, I mean, you played 13 nights at Madison Square Garden, and then you came back a couple months later and played how many nights did you guys play over New Year's? 4?
Yeah, and then the other thing is like to be what I was getting at was not like owning the room, but more like to have developed a relationship with the garden where they would engage with us in making this idea actually come to fruition. That mm-hmm. First of all, the only period of time during their calendar year where you could block out 20 days in a row or whatever to do it, but if you include days off, you know, and tech days and stuff. I mean, you know, for them to grant you that, for them to feel confident enough that, you know, you can sell enough tickets that it makes it worth their while to give you the Mondays and the Tuesdays and the Wednesdays, you know, they could have, you know, they could have other acts in there on those days of the week that, you know, they could, you know, Justin Bieber could go in there and sell the place out cold on a Tuesday and, mm-hmm. you know, or some, you know, and there's other artists that are way huger and it would, you know, and to have them accommodate us that way and give us that many days in a row, I don't even know if, you know, like the Taylor Swifts of the world, you know, the superstars could just do that.
Right.
I mean, I'm sure they could sell out the room. I'm not saying they couldn't sell the tickets. I'm just saying, like, the garden, the way they were, I don't know. The conversations I've had with people, and I don't know a lot of the people involved in the finer details of the arrangement part of it as much, but like, I don't know the conversations Corin had with them, but,
mm-hmm.
But I do know through little anecdotes that our managers have made and stuff is like, you know, this is the result of a long relationship that's built with this venue over many years, where it's a really healthy relationship, and mm-hmm. they really like you guys and they respect your organization and they're willing to do this. You right. know, it's they're fucking Madison Square Garden. They really don't have to right. do anybody, you know? And so that in and of itself is really cool.
Yeah.
And you know, an honor on its own level. Just the fact that they would have said yes to that
mm-hmm.
and taken the chance.
Yeah. It's quite the feat for you guys too, though. That's impressive.
Yeah, no, it was, I mean, no, they gave us a banner, you know. Jesus, yeah. That's so great. You know, that's so fun. I mean, you know, you got the Knicks, Billy Joel, and us hanging in the banners, you know, it's just
that's fun, insane, you know? Though. That's, yeah. Do you enjoy that stuff? I mean, do you get like, you know, do you stop and.
I really don't go in much for the awards aspect of anything that we do. I never, some of our records have sold a million copies or whatever, and we've gotten some, you know, they give you the platinum thing, whatever. And I haven't hung any of those on my wall, but I will say that one thing I do have hung on my wall is Delsner made us a plaque of the marquee of Madison Square Garden the first time we sold it out.
Mm-hmm.
This is like 1994, December 30th, Fish sold out on the marquee of the garden, and he took a picture of it and framed it and gave it to us with a piece of the ticket stub and a gaudy gold frame, you know, kind of, and nice matting behind it. And I have attempted to hang that on my wall, and it doesn't manage to stay. Like I can't quite. I don't know, but it's the only thing. And like the cover, our cover of Rolling Stone was mounted on a piece of wood that I've tried to hang on the wall too, and I can't quite leave it up there.
Why does it seem like braggadocious or something?
Well, I don't know. For me, I've looked at other people's like trophy rooms and thought like, oh wow, that's so cool. So it's not like I don't have an appreciation for it when it's somebody else's thing, but I guess the big secret is like, I'd be doing this for free anyway. Like if you give me an award for selling a certain number of tickets or something, it's not what I was in. I was in it to make a living, like to somehow do my favorite thing in the world and parlay that into a livelihood, like making those two necessities, doing something that you love and feel purpose in and making a living and putting food on your table. Those are both necessities, I think. And to have them be married into the same thing is fantastic. You know, mm-hmm. a lot of people have work that they do for money that, oh, they might like, they may do a good job, but that they're sort of, heart's love is like fishing,
right?
You know, and then if you know, like I've heard Taj Mahal say things like, you know, I go out on tour so I can make enough money to stay for as long as I can stay home and fish. If I can figure out a way to make money fishing, I'd never leave the house, you know.
Right.
You know, so you know, even people who are musicians, you know, they have, you know, that might not even be their first choice, you know. So you know, I could consider. So since that's the case, it's like I'm not going to say that the awards are meaningless because I don't want to sound like unappreciative or, you know, ungrateful or something. But right. it's not why I'm in it. It was never why I got into it. So it's the reward I'm seeking is that out of body experience, you know, like where things are, like where I was describing before and stuff. It's not or just the rush that comes with learning. This year, I'm finally starting to get good at the shuffle, like the Texas mm-hmm. shuffle, you know, I swear to God,
tough groove.
Go listen to the last version of Julius that we played. I swear to you, it's the best shuffle. You can listen to every other Julius we've ever played. And I'm telling you, the last version we did of it is the first time, I'm serious, the first time I feel like I actually played it. I started to get into the neighborhood of playing it the way where the pocket is really approximating contagion.
Really?
And where it's almost contagious. And I think there's a long way to go and it's going to get better. But right. I'm telling you, Julius, that feel and that song for our band is at the very beginning of it's going to get a lot better.
Really?
That feel is going to get a lot better from here on
when's
out.
When's the last time you played it? Did you guys play it over New Year's?
Yeah, we played it over New Year's.
All right, I'm going to go back. I'm going to listen to it.
Encore one of the nights, but it was like I just finally felt like I got that feel. And it's all because the drive of it is in the snare drum.
Mm-hmm.
It's on the ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. You know, I never really totally, you know, and the ride is just straight quarters and the kick drum pattern is real simple. It's, you know, and I actually even feel like I kind of went overboard when I started putting the kick drum on the and of one of the beats instead of just on the fucking downbeat. And I put an and even that made it a little herky jerky. Like, I ruined it, you know, like, mm-hmm. but, you know, it kind of left the pocket a little, or, you know, it brought it from the ass into the shoulders a little.
Right.
Like it goes from like, to like, you know, and, oh, it jumped up here. You know, push, get back down in there. Back in the fucking ass, back in the can. stay on the ground or, you know, stay, you know, keep the pocket going. And so it'll jump up to the upper body a little, or, you know, start headed toward the cerebral part.
Right.
You know,
I had Chris Layton from Double Trouble on the podcast, and, you know, we're just talking about his shuffle, and that dude is, I mean,
right.
Christ. You know, it's,
that's like a beastly shuffle. Yeah. You know, yeah, that's like the whole state of Texas.
Right.
In like a drum beat.
Yeah. Yeah. He's pretty insane.
It's just like Jesus Christ.
Forget it.
Yeah. Oh, that. Yeah. That. Right. And he's that. His art. Most of his shuffles like that are like these big, fat, swinging. You know, and they're sort of medium and slow tempo ones. Julius gets to like the thing about it. The shuffle too. Well, when you go listen to like that. Well, LaGrange is a great example, mm-hmm. but also like Freddie King.
Mm-hmm.
You know. I can't remember the name of his drummer there in the early 70s.
I don't know.
Guy, he played those Ludwigs that had the open, the concert tom Ludwigs. There's this one footage from some TV show. It's so great. They're doing this. And but it's a pretty good tempo. The thing
was
about
it
the shuffle.
Sonny Scott?
Yeah, it might be Sonny Scott. That name rings a bell. I feel like there's an L in the guy's name, though. Like,
I don't know,
like almost like KL, like, and weird. It's, I almost want to say like Kirk Livingston or something, like a name like that. Or,
yeah, I don't know.
Well, at any rate, there's this thing, and he's going, Freddie King's going, can you feel it? Can you feel it? You know, I can feel it. I can feel it. And you, I mean, when he asks the question, you know, he's asking the audience, you feel it? You feel right. that? You know, at the time, it's laughable because you feel it. You real like you get you completely are like yeah oh yeah I'm feeling, you know, and it's the shuffle is outrageous and it's at a pretty good clip, you know, it's at a little bit of a higher tempo, and the thing about that groove is like it seems to be it you know that's where it starts to become really precarious is when you start to get to the higher tempos,
mm-hmm.
that's where it starts to just come up out of the, you know, the tree gets a little unrooted and it starts to wave in the wind and you, right. you know, it starts to look like it's going to tip over. And that's, so I think that it's the trick is to stay, you know, to have that going pretty good, but to keep, you know, to stay back and have that backbeat really, really anchored, but, mm-hmm. but the flutter in the back. So that's the thing about that backbeat. It has to be that pop, but like you've got the dit, you know, dit and dit on either side of it, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- you know, they're just doing the, you know, the swung eighths. But when you get up in the faster tempos, it's like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-boom, da-da-da-boom. You know, the kick drum is filling the other spot. Da-da-da-boom, da-da-da-boom. And when you really get it locked down, it's like it really. I've had those moments where I was like, oh, I get why Freddie King said in that moment, you feel it. Do you feel it? It's like, oh, there it is. And I'm like just getting that now. And I'm 50 fucking 3 years old.
Right. It's a journey.
You know? But I will say, I do think, I mean, don't you think, would you agree with me? And I bet if you ask this of a lot of drummers on this podcast, I think that shuffle is generally speaking an Achilles heel of the average drummer.
I was just going to, before you asked that question, I was going to say, I think the shuffle is the hardest groove to play and most people don't know how to play it correctly.
I didn't really, I'm getting it now, mm-hmm. but I would 100% agree with that.
Yeah,
I've always been self-conscious of it. It's in the back of my mind. Like whenever we would play Julius or anything with that feel, I would always be like kind of unsure of myself. Like I'd be trying my best and mm-hmm. I'd get in the pocket and I would be trying to apply the Walter Payton thing. And I would be very conscious of that. I wasn't trying to overcomplicate it. I'm really trying to, but it just somehow would always feel like it would drift into the shoulders mm-hmm. and, you know, and kind of get into that area of, well, it's like, it's that beat that makes you feel really insecure because it's the thing that is this enough? Is this enough? Like mm-hmm. that question rises up in your head. Like, is this enough? You know, and you just have to go, yes, God damn it. This is enough. And not only is this enough, but if you don't shut up, you're going to ruin the whole fucking thing.
Right.
Like stop, ask the question and just relax and just play the damn thing. And as you're doing it, like, you know, find that backbeat and, you know, stick to it. Like don't hammer away at it, but stick to it like glue and then have everything else sort of mold in around it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the thing. It's like, you can't beat it to death either.
Yeah.
As soon as you start to, you know, it's one of those, it's like the groove that as soon as you start to kind of be like, God damn it, I want this thing to conform to what I, you know, it, mm-hmm. it just starts to get brittle.
If you're looking for a top-of-the-line snare, then look no farther than the Mapex Black Panther Design Lab series. These are designed to combine sound concepts to create unique and personal instruments for the demanding player. They come in three unique variations, and they all have their own unique sound quality to them. You have the Heartbreaker, which is dark and rustic and throaty. You have the Cherry Bomb, which is vintage, controlled, and precise. And then you have the Equinox, which will give you that classic, bright, articulate sound. To learn more about the Mapex Black Panther Design Lab series, go to mapexdrums.com. Right now, you are listening to this episode for free because of the great sponsors that we have, like ProMark and their new Firegrain drumstick. The new Firegrain utilizes a revolutionary heat-tempered process that transforms ordinary hickory drumsticks into precision tools with unprecedented durability. They keep their original weight and balance and feel, but these sticks allow drummers to hit harder and play longer naturally. There's no excess vibration, there's no gimmicks or anything like that. They're just natural hickory, but they're hardened by flame. So unlike any other drumstick that uses synthetic alternatives, Firegrain drumsticks feel like hickory because that's all they are. They also come in classic, forward balance, and select balance across a variety of sizes. To learn more, check out promarkdrumsticks.com. Now let's get back into it with John Fishman. To me, I always felt like all these things, because there's so much space, if you're playing, not if you're playing like a double shuffle or anything like that, but if you're just playing like literally like quarter notes on the hi-hat, I'm sorry, quarter notes on the ride, and just like this, just driving shuffle, there's so much space, and all of those limbs have to be in balance, and if they're not, then it gets, like you know, to use your words, like it gets, you know, it starts to come up in the shoulders, it feels really wonky, and getting that balance I struggle with it too. I think it's always been hard for me, but I think every drummer, I think it's one of the toughest to play, if not the toughest groove to play ever.
I think it is. I feel like it's the toughest one. It takes the longest to get really, truly good at. And it's funny too, because like even things like the Purdy shuffle kind of stuff, which is so funny that he put his name on that, because it's like, Jesus Christ, what the hell is, but you know, hey, but you know, that,
you know,
that
about
groove,
the signs that he did, right?
No.
Well, he would go into the studio and one sign said, "You done did it." And then the other sign says, "You done hired the hit maker," and he would set him next to the drums when he was practicing or when he was recording a record.
That is so great. That guy is so funny. He, I always just thought he had an incredible sense of humor. I love his instructional video.
Yeah.
And, but I mean, and what a groove. But you know, Porcaro plays it on that. You know, Rosanna and mm-hmm. Bonham. You know, it's Fool in the Rain, and you know, it's on lots of, you know, but that. I'd argue that beat is fucking easy compared to the straight quarter nut. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. When you take all the other stuff out of that, I'm like, I play that beat in Ocelot.
Uh-huh.
You know,
yeah.
Like, right? I mean, that beat, it kind of, because it all kind of, everything sort of falls into place, and you know, it's like there is more notes there, and there's the ghost notes and things.
I was going to say,
like,
there's less space.
There's less space, right? And yeah. And but it's funny though, because when you go to the opposite extreme, like if you play a beat that's just like ding ding pa, ding ding. Ding ding, that's comfortable too.
Mm-hmm. Like Lawn Boy or something.
Just a slow ballad kind of beat, like
Lawn Boy or something.
Right. That's yeah. But as soon as it hops up a little into from ding to pat to pat to pat to pat to pat, it starts to, like, something about it risks coming out. Up from the butt and getting up into the shoulders. This goes back to these conversations that, you know, in Fish we have, you know, this is an ongoing, you know, I love Yes and King Crimson and Genesis and all that, you know, mm-hmm. early, you know, art rock stuff, you know, and Zappa and everything, you know, and but then, you know, the great thing about the Stones and James Brown and everything is, like, you know, the perfect music is the stuff that equally satisfies the brain and the body, mm-hmm. like satisfies the whole physiological and spiritual being, you know, but I think if it reaches the brain and the body equally, it automatically, it involves the whole person and all the physiological things that go along with that, whether you call them spirit or the non-physical things too. It just affects,
right.
It gets the whole being vibrating in the same place.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, so I think you need both. And like, so at one extreme would be, like, say, King Crimson, Lark's Tongues and Aspic, which to me is one of the most incredible cerebral, you know, roller coaster rides, right? Mm-hmm. Right? But that's like the Maxell commercial with the guy glued to the chair with the hair back, you know, like, I really feel like my hair is blowing back and you're that, you know. But then you put on, like, James Brown, Love, Power, Peace or something like that, and it's you can't sit in that chair anymore.
Right.
There's all kinds of parts of you on the cellular level. You just starts like popcorn.
Mm-hmm.
You just start, you know, the next thing you're like, you have to be standing and like, holy, I can't believe, you know, your whole right. body's moving. And so, you know, I think for Fish, it's like the evolution that I feel like I hope that we keep to generate is music that's equally increasing the satisfaction of the brain and the body. That is like mm-hmm. Trading off one for the other.
Right.
And I think playing a really great shuffle has that essence to it, that it's like when you can really get a great shuffle going, there's like a physical part of it that's like, yeah, it swings, but it's kind of funky too. And it has a drive, like the James Brown stuff, you know, it's like kind of somewhere between a train and a funk and just a swing.
Mm-hmm. And I think that stuff all trickles down. Like, you get
it
that.
It creates a lot of place to, like, where all kinds of satisfying cerebral things can happen too. And it's.
Yeah. And I like, once it starts trickling down into your playing too, like, I think that, you know, that shuffle, like, perfecting that shuffle, I think helps playing just a regular groove too, you know, and everything else. It's just like.
Yeah. Because it raises your ceiling. It makes mm-hmm. everything else like relatively, and if you can manage to not panic there, then, you know, it's almost like instead of having a state of mind where it's like, well, I'm pretty good at all this other stuff as long as we don't shuffle, going from that to, well, I know I've got the shuffle in my back pocket if I need it. You know what I mean? It's like, it's like transforming. I like, ever since we played that Julius, I feel like a new person. It's almost like the Walter Payton, like a new level of like, yay, I've broken into this whole new neighborhood now. That's like an expanding field that I get to walk in now. And I get to, it's like a whole new, like a whole section of music that I have known. It's like the valley of, you know, it's like Shangri-La. So I know this place. I know this place exists. I finally get to see it.
I feel like you're going to be on stage, like looking around.
Walk around.
You're like, I feel like you're walking around, like you're going to be looking around on stage and be like, I bet these motherfuckers don't even know I can play a shuffle, you know?
Oh, well, I mean, and it doesn't even matter. It doesn't even matter if, like, we never, ever even play shuffle again. Just knowing. It's funny, the other night when I played at Bayside Bowl, you know, they started some song that was just a shuffle. And that was the second time in my life. The first was when we played that Julius, which was like as soon as Trey started playing it, I was like, aha, all right, here we go.
Step out of the way.
And then the second time was at Bayside Bowl. A guy started playing the shuffle, and the other drummer I was playing with is great, you know, young guy. But it was funny, though. I started playing the shuffle, and the whole thing just glued right together. Like the whole, you know, and I and it was being carried in the left hand, and you know, and it's, you know, the other guy that had probably the best up-tempo shuffle I've ever heard was Richie Hayward.
Yeah,
that's the thing. Like if you listen to Trump Tripe Face Boogie, you know that's fast. You know that's he's doing the instead of you know he's playing it like the full on four beats,
right?
You know, with three small hits and one big backbeat hit, and fucking killing it. The other guys that were amazing at it are BB King's drummers. I don't know. I mean, I know he's had a lot of drummers over the years, but on that live, there's the it's not Cook County Jail, but there's another one. It's like a live. Is it? There's one. It's just, you know, and they're, it's really like really all snare,
right?
And just the it's and it's not it's and it's just pumping along.
I love Art Blakey's shuffle.
I got
moaning.
A long way to go, huh?
The Art Blakey shuffle of moaning.
Oh my god! Oh, well, right. See, that's okay, right? Well, but I see now. Trey and I took a trip one time over to Europe, and we were street musicians over there, and we met these two mountain climbers. Actually, this one guy was a dentist, and his buddy, I can't remember what he did.
When was this? Was this years ago or?
Oh, it's like 1984 or something. Okay. Like right in the beginning of it. And we went over and we were on the plane. We were coming back and we were talking to these guys on the plane and they were like, yeah, we're just in Europe. And, you know, we were street musicians. We're talking. And he goes, yeah, well, me and my buddy are climbing enthusiasts. You know, we're mountain climbing, you know, we're climbers. But really my hero, and this guy was saying, so my hero is Reinhold Messner, right? You know who he is?
No.
So Reinhold Messner is like the legend in big wall mountain climbing.
Okay.
He's the legendary. There are no mountain climbers that don't know the name Reinhold Messner, the same way that there are no guitar players that don't know the name Jimi Hendrix.
I got you.
Like it's just, you know, there might be some out there that they don't know Hendrix, they know Segovia. Mm-hmm. You know, it's, you know, one of the he's the, you know, so
he's the
this guy went He's the guy who got the International Mountain Climbing Association's rating system to change their rating system to accommodate a feat that only he had accomplished and no one else. What he did was he climbed Everest and he climbed it without oxygen. And I don't know if he was the first. I think he was the first guy to climb it without oxygen. And so he said, you know, the highest rating you can get is a 6.12. 6.12 is like the steepest pitch or whatever the rating system, hardest level of difficulty, 6.12. And I should get a 7 because I went up this mountain that other guys have gone up before me, but they did it. Oh, I think he did it solo too. So exactly. I did it solo. I think the first time he did it like solo. I said, I'm the first guy to do it solo. So I should get a 7. And they go, no. So then he goes and does it solo with no oxygen. I don't know if I have all the facts exactly right. But he kept upping his game, right? So he does it now. He's done it. Okay, now I'm only got to do it solo, and now I've done it without oxygen. Now, come on. I get the 7, right? And they go, no, you don't get the 7. So then he does something like he goes up a route that's never been gone up before. He invents a new route with no oxygen, solo, and then he comes down a new route too. Like he establishes two new routes on the – some crazy shit like that.
Right.
it's finally, and he loses like three fingers and half his foot doing it, and you know,
of course,
and he does it in like record time, you know, and they finally, I think they give him the seven. I think the end of the story is they give him the seven. Anyway, so the guy is telling this story. So he says, you know, me and my buddies, we just me and my friend, we just like to go to like the first base camp that Reinhold Messner and just look up like that. This is high as we can go. I've gone to the first base camp and I'm at, you know, 17,000 feet, which is higher than I've ever been anywhere.
Yeah.
Whatever, you know, or it's 20,000 feet, you know, we'll go up to the 20,000 foot mark for a second base camp, whatever, you know, where, you know, it's very rigorous. You're at a super high altitude. You have to be in good condition and all that just to get there. He goes, but this is just, and that's as high as I can go. That's as hard as it gets for me. Beyond that, you know, it takes more skill and you know, endurance than I have. But I like to go there just so I can look up at where Reinhold Messner went.
Mm-hmm.
And we did this on K2 and we do it on Everest. And we go to all the different places he went and we do. So that's what, to me, I feel like, I don't know if I'll ever be able to get to the top of Everest, but I know now that I can get to the base camp from which I can see where Art Blakey's shuffle goes. Right. You know what I mean? Like that, you know, a la mode shuffle, like, you know, like where I'm like, okay, I get it now. I think I can see that place now.
Right.
I can't necessarily get there yet, but I can see how it can be done now, you know.
I'll hang out at the first base camp.
Right. Well, I mean, I'd love to get to the top, but I feel like I've gotten to the base, one base camp, you know, right. I'm like, oh yeah, all right. You know, like, you know, so that's very exciting, you know, because there's a lot of mountain in front of you now, you know, which is, and before I couldn't even, you know, get that far.
Mm-hmm.
Someone was like, well, there's this giant mountain over there. I'm like, I can't see it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I know. It's on the map, you know, here, listen to this recording. See, you get this proof that it's there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, how, you know, I can't do that. Fuck.
Yeah. The shuffle, man. It's the shuffle's brutal.
It's basic. Yeah. You have to. And it's funny how, you know, that's like one of those things that it took me so long to bring that up into the front part of my brain where I could actually sort of say it and acknowledge it. Like, Jesus, this is really hard. And it's almost as soon as I said that, like, I noticed all these other drummers going, yeah. I know what you mean, you know?
Yeah. Like, shit's hard, man.
It's amazing. So it's a really good feeling to be at this, you know, like I feel like I've got like a whole new part of my career in front of me.
That's awesome.
And now when I go and sit in with bands, it's like, hey, can we play a shuffle?
You know? Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Now I'm looking forward to listening to this, Julius. And
well, you know, it's so funny too, because recently I thought I almost had a gig with Billy Gibbons.
Oh, really?
Someone called me and said, oh, there's this gig. Billy Gibbons is going to be part of it. I was like, oh my God, I'm going to get to play LaGrange with Billy Gibbons. I can actually play the fucking shuffle. Oh my God. You know, and I've been playing two LaGrange like off of Tres Hombres like for like 2 weeks now. And then just today, the gig fell through. But I was like, hey, I got 2 weeks of solid shuffling my ass off. Like, I mean, these last 2 weeks, I'm talking about like, it's just brand new. Like, it was the Julius we just played. And I was kind of using LaGrange and the Freddie Green tune and Freddie King and some other shuffles that, you know, but I'll tell you, you know where Everest is? You'll know this when I say it. The top of the mountain is the Jabbo Starks original 1961 drumming of his on Bobby Boo Bland's Turn On Your Love Light.
Yeah.
The original version of Love Light. That shit is crazy. That fucking groove is so incredible. And the thing about it is, it's at like, I think it's something like 107 on the metronome or something. Right. It's fast. Yeah. I mean, for a shuffle. For a shuffle.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's a good clip. You know, it's hoppy. It's hopping right along.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's like the amazing thing about it is, you know how like when people are playing the swinging ace, like the ding, 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 ding on the ride, and they're doing the da-da-da-da-da-da-da in the snare accent, the accents tend to be on, like, I'm holding up my fingers here, but if these are the pairs of eighth notes, the accents are both on the back half of the, it's like da-ding, da-ding, da-ding on the downbeat.
Of,
you know, a one, a two, a three, a four, or, you know, and one, and two, however, you know, I think it's more like a one if you're thinking of it in swing, you know, like a one, a two, a three, a four, but, you know, so that feel, it's like the accents, but with that ride, what I realized is it's like the equivalent of going ting to patting, ting ting to patting, ting ting to pat, but with the doubles, it's like dudding, 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 one and two, and, you know, a one, a two, a three, a four, and you're going a one, you know, a two, a four, you know, you're going a two, a three, a four,
yeah, that,
you know, a two e, a four e, a two e, a four e, a two e, a four e, and over here you're going a one, a two, a three, a four. So when you're hitting hard on the two in this hand, you're doing a grace note in the right hand, and then the 16th note after that is an accent. So it's like ding ding ding, ding 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 ding, you know. I can't even sing it.
I know exactly where you're, I mean, I know the tune too, right? So
yeah. So you do that. Play like the shuffle and do in both in the left hand, don't do, you know, a one, a two, a three, a four. Just go a one, a two, a three, a four, you know, a two, a four, a two E, a four E, a two E, you know, as if it was one E and a two E and a,
right.
So two E, a four E, a two E, a four E. And on this hand, go one and two and three and four and one and two, and, but accent the and.
Yeah.
Accent the ands and lay the shoulder of the stick into the bell on the ands and then pull back and have the tip hit the bell on the downbeats. You have to do that really slow. Do it slow and get the feeling. You got it right out the gate. You want to go da-ding, 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 you know.
Right.
But it's like da-ding, 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 da-ding. It's like, and it's a completely different feeling. But when you get it, you get it. You're like, oh, and I have it, but the fastest I can do it is like 80.
Yeah,
like, you know, when I go look at what the tempo is, I'm at fucking 80, and then I listen back to the recording, and that's the other thing about the recording is in your brain you think it's faster than it is. It's actually slower than you end up thinking it is, but it's still too fast for you to play.
Sure.
Like, I mean, I'm sure Dennis Chambers and these guys, you know, can, whatever, they sure they. For me though, that's a huge, big project. Like, that's going to take a long time. But I think
I'll throw one. I'll throw one on top of that pile for you. You know the tune "Kissing My Love," the Bill Withers tune.
Is it one of the?
So it's an earlier one of his tunes. James Gatzett's playing drums. He's playing this like this swung 16th note thing, and he's accenting, he's doing the same thing, but it's like this swung shuffle, and it's like, but the way that he's accenting the eighth notes actually on the hi-hat, he's like, it's like a one, a two, a three, a three, a two, a two, you know what I mean? So right. It's like a one, a two, a three, a three, a two, a two, a two, a two, a two, a two, but it's like, but it's up tempo, you know, it grooves its ass off, obviously, because it's James Gatson. And, but when I first listened to it, I was like, oh, I can play this. And I was like, wait a minute. He's swinging these eighths. And he's not only swinging these eighths, but he's accenting these eighths. Swung differently. Actually, it's like
he's actually the front of the pairs of ace instead of the back.
Yeah.
And I'm going to go a step further with that and say, I'll bet that the reason he played it that way is because of Turn On Your Love Light. I bet he got it from Jabo Starks. I actually think that groove on that record from 1961 might be responsible for the basic feel of rock and roll. I know that Chuck Berry and all of us came before that record, you know, and there was rock and roll. And, you know, I mean, the feel of rock and roll came from Chuck Berry and unknown, unrecorded sources before him who, you know what I mean? Who kind of, you know, I mean, it really came from, you know, Howlin' Wolf and Robert Johnson and people like that too. But I'm just saying like that, you know, but Chuck, if you think about Chuck Berry too, you know, da 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 da. I mean, it's the Shuffle, you know?
Yeah.
And Richard, you know, that was going on. But I think that like that doom da doom da doom da doom da da doom da 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 doom, that gallopy hopping thing, like, you know, I know that that was a huge aspect of where, you know, Kreutzmann was coming from the Dead. I know that affected the Allman Brothers and that generation. I'm guessing, though, in the black community and the soul music and that culture, I mean, Jabbo went to fucking James Brown.
Yeah.
You know, he and Clyde, you know, he went from the Church to Bobby Bland to James Brown's band. I mean, played with lots of other people too, but that feel, I mean, if Gadsden's accenting the you know, the uhs instead of the downbeats in the ride, I'm guessing that that came from,
he's doing it on the hi-hat, but I think that you might be right. I don't know.
Yeah, sure, but I'm just saying, I just think that general,
I'll send it to you to listen to. Check it out. I think, like,
yeah, I definitely want to hear that. Anything with that thing on it now, I want to eat that up because I think it's just, you know, or maybe, I mean, the other way to think of it is maybe Jabbo and Gadsden got it from Art Blakey.
Yeah, true.
1940, you know, like with, you know, Monk, Rick,
right,
Clyde,
right, right.
One, you know, or whatever, you know, it's like, you know, so I mean, it's just many, many places where, you know, I'm not enough of a music historian to know. I'm sure there would are drummers that will listen to this if they hear this portion of it and go, God, that guy's an idiot, he's completely missing the, you know, it's like Jabbo got it from blah 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 blah, you know. Right. And, you know, but, oh, I can go that far back at least, and I know that that was for all the people that came after that, it was hugely influential because you can definitely hear it, and you hear people talk about it too.
Right.
Well, like, the Dead covered that song, you know, and you know those early recordings of the Dead, and it's like, oh man, he, you know, Bill Kreutzmann must have been a big fan of that,
right?
You know, and but there's a lot of it. I even in things like, I don't know, like I hear it like in Canned Heat and stuff, you know, from that era, you know, the late 60s, early 70s. And it just, when I heard that record, I just remember thinking like, oh my God, this is where it comes from, you know?
Yeah.
This is where that thing, you know, because it's so clear there. It's that, like, that's what it is, you know?
I'm going to talk to a buddy of mine. There's a guy, a buddy of mine, Daniel Glass. He actually does a podcast on Drummer's Resource too. But he's an amazing player, but he's also an historian. So he does, like, he'll take a groove and he'll break it down. He'll figure out the origin of it and go back and back and back.
Probably know for sure a lot of the stuff then. Yeah, yeah.
I'll ask him about it.
Yeah, I'd like to know. I'd like to know what his response to that would be, if he traces it further back or credits it really to somebody else, or, you know, but it would be interesting to see what his perspective as an actual historian would be on the Jabbo Starks, the Bobby Bland recording, where sits in that lineage.
Yeah, I'll ask.
But that's the first thing for me is getting a good solid, like, you know, Lagrangey type groove, and then I really want to get good at that Lovelight groove. I remember mentioning that to Jeff Sipe, like in '92 or something, and his response at the time was, I said, man, Bobby Bland, because it's so incredible, that groove. And he goes, oh yeah, that's a lifetime. That's the kind of the groove you can study for a lifetime.
Yeah.
And I got it then, but now I really get it, because I really do feel like, you know, I would love for just one moment to be able to actually almost be like able to make an impression of it the way that, you know, a good comedian can do an impression of, you know, Donald Trump or, you know, like, you know, like that guy, Frank Caliendo, who sounds exactly like John Madden. Like, he can sound.
I know who you're talking about.
Never know that it's not Madden, you know, or there's some people that are, their impressions are so good. And even though they don't look anything like, you know, Jimmy Fallon's got some of these, even though they don't look anything like the person, you're totally seeing and hearing, you know, John Madden when you're looking at Frank Caliendo.
Right.
Oh my God. I would love for 1 second to be able to like play that groove and have it sound like, you know, just, wow, you achieved sounding like Jabbo Starks on that record for one measure.
Right. Right.
Just to feel that, you know, like
I feel like you said something like that on Bittersweet when you were like, I felt like I was as funky as James Brown on his worst night.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
You're like, that's what I want to do.
Right. It's like getting to the base camp. Like I got the glimpse, like for one measure, for one night. Like I know what it, you know, like we were as good as James Brown on his worst night, which means that, you know, we got into the pocket enough to see the depth of that ocean. You know,
like we did something,
you know, yeah. We could see the creatures down there. We just couldn't go to them.
I love it.
Yeah. It's and then the great thing is that everyone has their own perspective. You know, I view it that way. Somebody else is saying, oh, you know, it's at the same time, it's great to hear, you know, from you that like I'm part of what got you to play drums. That's so great. I'm grateful that I can be for someone else that what, you know, James Gadsons and Jabbo Starks of the world were for me.
Right.
You know,
right.
You know, and so I feel good about that, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you shaped you were, Phish was like the gateway drug for me into a lot of other bands, into a lot of different music. I mean, there was stuff that you guys would play that I would, you know, covers that I would find who the original was. It was stuff that you would play during set breaks that I would find out who they were. I mean, and just like, I don't know. I mean, I went to, you know, I've been to 90 shows. So like you guys have definitely shaped a lot of my music.
And a lot of the stuff that you just mentioned there too is really, that's also a result of the whole being greater than the sum of its parts. Like all the music that was picked between those sets has been Jason Colton, mostly one of our managers is, you know, he was John Peluska's sort of right-hand guy in the Dionysian days. And then he moved on to Red Light and works with Korn and Patrick and over there now. And he is largely, I think Patrick does too, you know, but that's our manager guys who are like huge music fans themselves. And they have ear to the ground, I think, a lot more than we do in some ways, you know, because they manage other bands of different types of music. And so they're aware of like other goings on and developing things in the music world, you know, like one of the other bands that Jason manages is the Punch Brothers, you know, who are, you know, world-class, amazing, you know, and so through that, you know, there's going to be all kinds of exposure to, you know, things that you might hear. I would hear, you know, like I've been walking off the stage and heard music coming out of our sound system. I was like, wow, I got to ask Jason who that is.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's just the Phish organization as a whole, really, you know, I think the band sets a good tone that way because our joy of getting to create what we do rubs off on the people around us. And I think everybody kind of gets on board with it and kind of gives it their best too.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah. Yeah. Well, we're lucky people.
Well, so are we. Thank you for doing what you do. We appreciate it. And thanks for shaping my music, my musical tastes and career and what I've decided to do with my playing. So.
Yeah. Now all you need to complete the misinformation and the total ruination of everything, of destroying what could have been a very positive musical life for you is to get my senior study from Goddard and have your head just go the wrong way when you're thinking of downbeat and upbeat, and just that'll set you off running in the exact wrong direction.
Perfect.
Which will probably lead to something fantastic.
Yeah. Well, when you find it, let me know. I definitely want to check it out if you're open to me reading it.
Yeah. Maybe I'll go dig it out and see, look at it. If there's anything, if I agree with enough of it, I'll write Goddard and tell him they can put it out. I don't know. It's funny. I always thought that anybody could walk in and
No, I don't. I guess that's not what I hear. That's what I read on the internet, so it's got to be true because it's on the internet.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you know, libraries. You know, libraries are generally places of like take out a book and look at it, right? Isn't that what
I guess
I don't
not.
Know, maybe
I guess right? not.
No, not that. Don't look at that.
Yeah.
Just look at it. It's like that Residence thing where, you know, the album where they made it because the purest art is art that's never actually meant to be seen. So they made it for its own thing and stuck it in a closet. And that's their best album.
Who knows? It could be the next seminal.
It's the greatest, right? It's,
drum text.
It's the actual help. It's the helping friendly book. Yeah. You can't see it. Everything.
Nice.
There's nothing friendly about it. That's the big secret.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, my man. Well, I sincerely appreciate this. I have.
I'm sorry it went as long as it did.
Man, I could sit here and talk to you all night. Well, thank you
good
again.
Talking to you,
yeah, man. Likewise. And get some sleep. Thank you again. Yeah. I appreciate it.
All right. Take care.
Take care. Bye. See ya. So there you have it. The epic 3.5-hour conversation I had with John Fishman from Fish has come to a conclusion. I hope you dug that. And for me, I mentioned this before, that was a very, very special conversation for me to have, as I've been a Fish fan since I was 15 years old and have been to 90 shows. And he is really the one that made me want to pursue playing drums professionally and made me, for some reason, believe that it was possible. So to be able to sit down and chat with him was an amazing experience, and I really hope that you enjoyed it, and I would love to hear your feedback on it, whether it be on iTunes, or you can, you know, message me on, I'm on Instagram and Twitter and all that fun stuff at Drummers Resource, or shoot me an email, nick@drummersresource.com, and until the next podcast, keep drumming. Thank you so much for listening. I really do appreciate it, and I'll be talking to you soon. Peace.